one and the other. I was reading Dawkins's book, The God Delusion. He says, well, which is it? Is it the anthropic principle or is it creation? Well, why can't it be both? Why not both? You say, well, is that person an engineer or is it a woman? Well, what kind of prejudice do you have? Why can't it be both? Cobb County, Georgia, that's where I live. From 02 to 05, they had stickers in the science textbook saying, evolution is a theory, not a fact. What is driving this? What is driving this? Part of it, I think, is an anti-religious bias in the people who create, who are in charge of education. But we also have people who pour kerosene on the fire. Richard Dawkins, the most articulate, colorful exponent of evolution there ever was. But look what he says. It's absolutely safe to say that if you meet someone who claims not to believe in evolution, that person is ignorant, stupid, or insane. Did you get that? Those are strong words. In other words, you're intellectually dwarfed. You're a midget. I mean, who are you, puny brain, if you don't accept that? Hitchens, and he's even stronger in a way. I mean, there's religions run out of justifications. His book, his latest book, God Is Not Great, God with a small g, because he won't even capitalize the name, how religion poisons everything. It's not just on the secular side, it's on the religious side. Expelled came out earlier this year, 2008, and Expelled overstates. Actually, Michael Shermer is in the film. Very interesting. But it goes too far. It's too one-sided. Henry Morris, who died 2 years ago, head of the Creation Research Institute, says there are only two basic worldviews. There's no evidence that the world is old. Now, I wrote to him. I wrote to him some years ago. He wrote me back, to his credit. But I wanted engagement about the actual issue. Before, when I was a young Earth creationist, I read 150 books and pamphlets and articles by Morris and by his friends. And I wanted some engagement. That's what I need. Interestingly, you'd never know this. Michael and I were both drawn into young Earth creationism. We were both young Earth creationists back in the 70s and ardent. And I think we did our best to support it. Now, Michael, I'm taking a shot at you, but you go second, so it's not really that bold of me. You said in your book, How We Believe, which you gave to me at last year's debate. I appreciate that. I love the book. You said the fossil record screams out evolution, not creation. Well, why not both? 10 pages later, you say the whole point of faith, in fact, is to believe regardless of the evidence, which is the very antithesis of science. But that's not the point of faith. Faith involves trust, but faith is also a response to evidence, Hebrews 11:1. A few months ago, I took my wife to the opera. We like that song, Nessun Dorma. We like Turandot. So I took her to the opera. Now, to confess to you, today when I was driving to Gainesville, I was listening to bluegrass. But I was more sophisticated then. So I'm listening to opera, and someone says, oh, you were deceived. It wasn't music. It was simply sound waves. See, the equations of wave propagation explain it all. That came in into your auditory canal, the tympanic membrane, and converted into some kind of pulse that traveled up into your brain. You thought it was music. It wasn't music at all. It was just sound waves. Well, wouldn't we say that person may be right on the acoustic side, but totally wrong as far as what music is. We've got to move away from the conflict model. What does the Bible actually say? Psalm 19 says that God has two books. He speaks to us through nature. He speaks to us through his word. And these books don't contradict each other. That's where I'm coming from. If we've got a conflict, we better work on that. You'd say, okay, what does Genesis say? Doesn't that say instantaneous creation? No. If that does, then Isaiah 43 has Israel being created instantly. Same verb. Actually, a process that took hundreds of years. And the truth is, God's normal way, whether it's plate tectonics or photosynthesis, nuclear fusion, forestation, crystal growth is through processes. A snowflake occurs naturally if the conditions are right, and yet God does it. We're fearfully and wonderfully made, Psalm 139, and yet it's a process we all go through. It's not instantaneous. If I had time, I would tell you about Genesis 4, which seems to imply that there was an outside world, which Cain found. The point is, you can be a scientist and believe in God. And many scientists, in fact, do believe in God. From Francis Collins, head of the Genome Project, the preeminent scientist of the United States, to Owen Gingerich of Harvard, the astronomer, even Stephen Jay Gould, who died some years ago, was an agnostic, but please listen to what he says. Either half my colleagues are enormously stupid, or else the science of Darwinism is fully compatible with conventional religious beliefs. Even Billy Graham, this will shock some people, he said that, well, God created man, whether by evolution or not, is irrelevant. It doesn't change the fact that God created man. Whichever way God did it makes no difference. Let's move towards a conclusion right now. The existence of the universe is highly unlikely. The life coming to the universe itself is very unlikely, as many scientists agree. So what makes best sense of the evidence? Evolution that's aimless, that is disteleological, or evidence or evolution that's guided by God or originally set up by God, teleological? That's the question. Human consciousness and intelligence, what makes more sense? That they came from a world that lacks consciousness and intelligence, or that a conscious and intelligent creator is behind them? And these days, some people will say, well, we have parallel universes. String theory. Michael, in your book, you talk about why Darwin matters. 10 to the 500th power universes, baby universes popping into existence out of black holes, oscillating universes, quantum foam, natural selection of universes, a la Smolin. What is going on? We're moving into metaphysics. And I say, if it's acceptable to postulate a hypothetical universe, it's certainly acceptable to postulate a God. Michael, you said maybe our universe simply popped into existence out of the quantum fluctuation of the vacuum of some larger multiverse. Yeah, maybe. Maybe our universe is just one of those things that happened for no reason at all. Do you really believe that? And I'm not just talking, I'm talking to everybody. Do you really think that it just happened for no reason at all, that the whole cosmos is disteleological, there's no direction? We can boil it down in the words of the famous African proverb, no rain, no mushrooms, no God, no world. This is my position.
Thank you, Doctor. We can just leave it. Dr. Shermer, at your start, you have 20 minutes.
Good evening, how we doing? Thank you, Andrew, for that kind introduction. Thank you to Access for bringing us here and to the university. I read on the internet today, so it must be true, that this is the biggest party school in America. So I went to Neiman Marcus, I bought a new suit. I got the Sarah Palin collection today. Do you like it? Yes? I got my tax refund. So I'm the publisher of this magazine, Skeptic Magazine. We investigate claims of the paranormal, pseudoscience, fringe groups, and cults, and claims of all kinds between good science, junk science, voodoo science, pseudoscience, pathological science, non-science, and plain old nonsense. And unless you've been abducted by aliens and been on Mars for the last couple decades, you know there's a lot of it out there. Nonsense, that is. That is, we debunk things, but let's face it, there's a lot of bunk out there, so somebody has to do it, so that's part of our job.